Moses, in whom you have put your hope, is the very one who will accuse you. If you had really believed Moses, you would have believed me, because he wrote about me. But since you do not believe what he wrote, how can you believe what I say?
It was so powerful that when Isaiah received the vision, that he said, nobody's going to believe it. That's how he starts. This whole prophecy shook his inner being because God has given him a complete picture and detailed description of what Messiah is going to look like, what he's going to do, and how he's going to die. And, I mean, there are other prophecies that come together with that, but this is really the central column of messianic prophecies.
The accuracy of Isaiah's prophetic vision is underscored in the biblical accounts of Christ's trial before Pontius Pilate. By arrest and judgment, he was taken away.
We know historically that Pilate was walking on eggshells with the Jewish people. He had had some earlier confrontations with them, and he did not need another confrontation. I think if it was within his power, and he was not already in a conflicted situation with the Jewish people, he would have released Jesus. But because if he had one more incident, it could be a riot, he had to do something. Again, God was behind the scenes orchestrating these events.
In their second encounter, Pilate interrogated Jesus alone in his chambers.
Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world, but it is from another place. For this reason, I came into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me."
Stunned by the power of Christ's response, Pilate turned away to address the crowd that had gathered in the courtyard of the Praetorium.
"I find no basis for a charge against him," Pilate said. "What shall I do then with Jesus who is called the Christ?" They all answered, "Crucify him."
Despite the Jews' rejection of his appeal for mercy, Pilate made another desperate attempt to save Jesus from the cross. He ordered that Christ be beaten and scourged.
"He was led like a lamb to the slaughter."
People in the ancient world understood what a Roman flogging was like, and that it was a horrendous beating that left Jesus in hypovolemic shock, which is shock because of great blood loss.
Normally that meant 40 lashes, less one for mercy. 39 lashes with the Roman whip, with a cat of nine tails, with broken pieces of metal and glass in the whip to rip the flesh open.
And so it would rip into the skin, then it would rip into the skeletal tissue. Many men did not survive the actual scourging process, but again, even that was a fulfillment of Scripture.
With each lash of the Roman whip, Isaiah's predictions of a Messiah beaten mercilessly for the sins of all humanity were graphically fulfilled.
"I offered my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who pulled out my beard. I did not hide my face from mocking and spitting. And by his stripes, we are healed."
Following Christ's brutal scourging, Pilate appealed to the crowd for the final time. He presented Jesus, beaten and crowned with thorns, with the hope they might have mercy upon him.
When Jesus came out wearing a crown of thorns, Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." The chief priests shouted, "Crucify, crucify. Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews, "Shall I crucify your king?" "We have no king but Caesar. Crucify him." When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood. It is your responsibility." And he handed Jesus over to be crucified.
Now we have to understand that in the plan of God, all of this would fulfill what God had predicted in the future. The story of the crucifixion is not blamed on the Jews any more than it's blamed on the Romans and the Italians, any more than it's blamed on Germans and Americans, because Jesus is going to the cross to die for the sins of all mankind, and it's our sins that nail him to the cross. These are merely the human players in the story, and the amazing thing is we would never remember who Pontius Pilate was. We would never remember who King Herod was. They would have been forgotten by the sands of time had their lives not intersected the life of Jesus Christ. And he rises above the critics, the Pharisees and the scribes and the priests. He rises above the Roman governor until you are transfixed on one life, one Savior, one man who is willing to die for the sins of the world because he is God incarnate in human flesh.
Jerusalem bears little resemblance to the city where Jesus suffered and died. In the wake of its turbulent history, virtually all of its walls and buildings have been destroyed and reconstructed several times since the week of Christ's Passion. Yet today, pilgrims from throughout the world are still drawn to the narrow streets of the Eternal City to reflect upon a death unprecedented in its meaning, anguish, and prophetic significance.
The crucifixion itself was designed by the Romans to extract maximum suffering.
The streets going into the cities of Rome were often lined with crucified men as a warning to anybody who would dare to defy this political power. So it was designed to humiliate, to torture, to bring pain, and ultimately, over a period of days, to bring death.
So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which is called Golgotha. There, they crucified him.
The crucifixion of Jesus is the foundation of Christian theology and the centerpiece of the Passion story. Since the 3rd century, several locations in and around Jerusalem have been theorized to be the actual site where Christ died. The two most celebrated include the plot of land upon which the Church of the Holy Sepulchre was first constructed in 330 AD. And this barren outcropping of rock outside the northern wall of the city. While the Hebrew prophets made no attempt to identify the exact location of Christ's crucifixion, they did describe, often in precise detail, the events surrounding the death that changed history.
It's important to understand that the description of the crucifixion in the ancient Hebrew writings takes place before crucifixion was even implemented as a method of torture and death by the Romans.
When David wrote Psalm 22, crucifixion hadn't even been invented yet, hadn't even been thought of. It would have been considered inhumane in the ancient Middle East. And yet the Roman government decides this is one way, when you've conquered a country, to subjugate these people and keep them under authority, crucify as many as you have to, terrorize the population into submission.
The actual term crucifixion is not used in the Old Testament. However, there are several ancient references that clearly indicate it was the means of capital punishment by which the Messiah would die. As a result, the fulfillment of messianic prophecy hinged upon a specific historical chronology.
the Messiah has to come during the period of the Roman Empire. It's only in that narrow window of time when the Roman Empire rules the world that crucifixion is the means of execution, and Jesus comes at the right time, dies the right way in fulfillment of those prophecies. David literally looks down through the halls of history, down through the corridor of time, and 1,000 years in the distance sees the Savior suffering and dying and describes it for us in Psalm 22.
Biblical scholars have long studied the correlation between the writings of David, Zechariah, and Isaiah, and the gospel accounts of Christ's death. When these Old and New Testament scriptures are compared side by side, the prophetic implications of the passion of Christ are fully realized.
A band of evil men has encircled me. They have pierced my hands and my feet.
And they nailed Jesus to a cross.
To intensify the pain of crucifixion, Roman soldiers attached victims to the cross by driving spikes 5 to 7 inches long through the hands or wrists and feet. Like David, the prophet Zechariah foretold the wounds created by this torture centuries before the nails ever pierced Christ's body.
They will look on me, the one they have pierced, and mourn for him as one who mourns for an only child.
On Friday morning, the cross was raised at Golgotha. Pilate had a notice attached above Christ's head proclaiming the charge against him in 3 languages. Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. During the next 6 hours, at least 12 specific prophecies were fulfilled.
He poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors.
They crucified 2 thieves with him, one on his right and one on his left.
All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him.
Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him."
They divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing.
A complete picture and detailed description of what Messiah is going to look like, what he's going to do, and how he's going to die.
The accuracy of Isaiah's prophetic vision is underscored in the biblical accounts of Christ's trial before Pontius Pilate.
By arrest and judgment, he was taken away.